Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship on this breezy third Sunday after Epiphany. If we want it to warm up, we got to go through this, don't we? Strong south breeze. But I think we'd all appreciate a little bit of warmth, so we'll deal with it. Pastor Chuck and Pastor Stephanie are gone this week. They are at a conference as part of their continuing education, so I'm filling in and we'll do our best. So we will start our worship today with the gathering song, Here I Am, Lord, hymn 752 in your With One Voice hymnal.
Thank you.
We'll be using the service of word and prayer order of service in your With One Voice hymnal on page 46, or you can follow along on the screen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In the beginning was the Word. In the Word was life, and the life was the light of all people. The Word became flesh and lived among us.
And we have seen his glory, full of grace and truth.
We will now continue by singing our scripture song, Listen, God is Calling, hymn 712. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together our prayer of the day. Almighty God, by grace alone you call us and accept us in your service. Strengthen us by your Spirit and make us worthy of your call. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The first reading today is from Jonah, the third chapter. The book of Jonah is a comedy starring a reluctant prophet who is given a one-sentence message: Nineveh will be destroyed in 40 days. Much to Jonah's dismay, the people of Nineveh repent. The point of the story is to get the reader to wrestle with the question, on whom should God have mercy? The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim it to the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed in God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. And when God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. Here ends the reading. We'll now read together Psalm 62, verses 5 through 12. "For God alone I wait in silence. Truly my hope is in God. In God is my deliverance and my honor. God is my strong rock and my refuge. Those of high degree are but a fleeting breath. Those of low estate cannot be trusted. Placed on the scales together, they weigh even less than a breath. God has spoken once, twice have I heard it, that power belongs to God. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians, the 7th chapter. Paul does not disapprove of marriage or other human social institutions. He does, however, want Christians to live in the present in fervent anticipation of God's future, which even now has dawned through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short. From now on, let even those who have wives be as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no possessions, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. Here ends the reading. Please rise, everyone, and we will speak together the gospel acclamation. Alleluia. The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 1st chapter. Before Jesus calls his first disciples, he proclaims a message that becomes known as the gospel, or good news from God. God is ready to rule our lives. Those who realize this will respond with repentance and faith. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And as he went a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Our gospel text today comes from Mark. Mark begins his gospel telling with John the Baptist as an adult, preaching about the coming of one mightier than he, one for which the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. The Gospel of Mark completely leaves out the origin story of John the Baptist and of that mightier one, Jesus. In fact, the entire Christmas story is omitted. There is no Virgin Mary, no Joseph, no visit to cousin Elizabeth, so John the Baptist, still in Elizabeth's womb, can leap for joy at the sound of Mary's voice. There is no trip to Bethlehem to be counted in the census, no manger, no shepherds, no wise men. After introducing us to John the Baptist, that snappy dresser that loves eating locusts and honey, we have Jesus coming to John to be baptized. And as Jesus comes out of the water, a voice from heaven says, "You are my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." And now we reach our gospel lesson for today, still in the first chapter of Mark at verse 14. We are told that John the Baptist has been arrested. I find this interesting because at this point in Mark's telling, he doesn't explain why John was arrested or who arrested him. In fact, Mark waits until his sixth chapter to inform us that, well, since Mark chooses to wait for this part of the story, I will respect his wishes and not spoil it here for you today. No, today we are talking about the beginning of Jesus' ministry. First, Mark tells of Jesus coming to Galilee and proclaiming the good news of God. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news," Jesus tells the people. Next, Jesus goes to the Sea of Galilee, where he spots the men who will become his first two disciples, Andrew and his brother Simon. They are in their boat and in the process of throwing out their nets to catch some fish. He calls out to their boat and says, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Other older Bible versions word this a bit differently, using a turn of phrase on the word fisherman, as Jesus says, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." In any case, Mark tells us that upon hearing Jesus' call to follow me, the two brothers immediately leave their nets and follow him. Jesus is only half done with his calling of disciples that day. Mark tells us that Jesus goes a little farther and finds two other brothers, James and John, mending their fishing nets. James and John's father, Zebedee, happens to be in the boat with them, along with some hired men. Mark tells us that Jesus immediately calls them, and they leave their father and the hired men behind. Can you imagine what the old man thought about that? Here's a stranger calling to them from shore, somebody that, as far as we know, was completely unknown to them, and he says, "Follow me," and they're like, "Okay, see you later, Dad." We are not told of Jesus making any introduction. "Here I am, everyone, the Messiah, the Son of God. I'm going to need some help later on telling my story of hope and love and forgiveness." None of that. No introduction, no sales pitch, no justification of why they are needed, or for that matter, what they are really signing up for. But you know something? If Jesus had explained to them exactly how things were going to go, exactly what lay in store for him, and exactly what lay in store for them, his new disciples, yeah, perhaps full disclosure would have been a poor recruiting strategy. Our Old Testament reading this morning discusses another call from the Lord, this one to Jonah. This book of the Bible, Jonah, is a relatively short one, only four chapters in length. Our lesson today starts with the third chapter and begins like this: "The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time." The word of the Lord to Jonah came to Jonah a second time. Now, I remembered from my Sunday school days the story of Jonah and the whale, but frankly, I couldn't remember much else about Jonah. And this notion of the Lord's voice coming to Jonah a second time had me wondering, what about the first time? So I went back to the first chapter of Jonah and started reading, and guess what? The first time the Lord contacts Jonah is exactly like the second time. The Lord says to Jonah, "Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me." Well, upon hearing this, Jonah decides he wants nothing to do with going to Nineveh. So he runs from the Lord, ends up on a boat. The Lord whips up a terrible storm. The sailors on the boat figure out Jonah is the reason they are likely to perish. And with Jonah's blessing, the sailors throw him in the water, and the storm immediately calms. And the Lord sends a large fish to swallow Jonah, where he spends the next 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale. And finally, Jonah prays a lengthy prayer to the Lord, which is essentially the entire second chapter of the book of Jonah, essentially saying, "I'm sorry." Then the fish vomits him out onto dry land. And here we are back to our Old Testament lesson for today. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Well, guess what? Jonah says, "Yes, sir, Lord, I'm heading to Nineveh." So with the Lord's call to Jonah, Jonah knew exactly what he was asked to do, but he doesn't want to do it. It ends up taking a terrible storm and getting puked out of a whale's belly for Jonah to finally accept his call from the Lord. By contrast, I'm struck by the simplicity of the call to our first four disciples: Simon, who Jesus would later name Peter, his brother Andrew, and the sons of Zebedee, James and John, who Jesus would later dub the sons of thunder. "Follow me." And they followed. They answered his call, and it is quite clear that they had no idea what their future held. Andrew really isn't mentioned much in the gospel texts, but he does have a big moment during the feeding of the 5,000 in John's gospel. It is Andrew who comes to Jesus with a boy who has five small barley loaves and two small fish, and he states, "But how far will they go among so many?" Well, we know how the rest of that story plays out. Tradition says that Andrew was crucified around 60 AD in Greece, a martyr for his Lord. This is not mentioned in the Bible, but some early Christian writings claim that Andrew insisted of his captors that he not be crucified in the same way that Jesus had been crucified. So they tied him to the cross versus nailing him to it, and the cross was hung in an X shape instead of the T shape used for Jesus. We know much more about the other three disciples called by Jesus in our gospel today. Simon was named Peter by Jesus, as Peter literally translates to rock. Jesus said Peter would be the rock upon which he would build his church. We know that Peter denies knowing or being affiliated with Jesus during his trial and crucifixion. We know that Peter gives a sermon on the day of Pentecost, revealing to the crowd that the folks speaking in tongues are not drunk, and that indeed the Holy Spirit has descended upon them. He testifies to Jesus' death and resurrection. He explains to the crowds that they had crucified their Messiah, but in spite of that, they could repent and be baptized and receive the Holy Spirit. Peter is considered to be the first pope of the Catholic Church and is certainly one of the most important figures in the New Testament and in the early Christian Church. Peter's death also cannot be found in the Bible. Early tradition is that Peter, like his brother Andrew, was crucified for his preaching by the Emperor Nero shortly after the Great Fire of Rome in 64 AD. And like his brother, Peter stated he was not worthy to be crucified like Jesus, and so he was hung on his cross upside down. James, along with Peter and John, is considered one of the most trusted of the disciples, being present with Jesus during the Transfiguration and in the Garden of Gethsemane on the Mount of Olives at the time of Jesus' arrest. James is also the first disciple to be martyred and the second disciple to die after Judas, around 44 AD. James's death is mentioned in the Bible, in the book of Acts. The Bible says that he was arrested by King Herod and put to death by the sword in Jerusalem. Tradition is that he was beheaded for his preachings. And finally, we have John. Of the disciples, John is the only one that is not killed as a martyr for Jesus. John preaches and he writes his gospel account, his three epistles, and upon being exiled to the island of Patmos, he writes his book of Revelation. It is believed that he lived to be about 93 years old, dying around 100 AD. Now, it's clear to me that these four disciples are a large reason behind why we are here today, in this place, hearing the good news of the Lord. Had they not answered their call, we can only speculate how the future of the Christian church may have been different. Had they known their fate, especially the ones that were martyred, killed for their faith and belief in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, would they have reacted like Jonah did? Might they have fled, ran from the Lord, ran from Jesus, or perhaps just pretended not to hear Jesus' call from shore? Well, there's no reason to speculate, because they didn't. They were called, they followed, and the rest, as they say, is history. Now, some of you may be thinking, great history lesson, Jim. A real pick-me-up this morning, all this talk of martyrdom and fish barf. But what does this mean for us? Well, for me, it means be ready, be aware, be present, and be willing. Because your call could be on the way. It could be a call on behalf of the Lord, like a call to visit a loved one who has fallen ill, or to check on a neighbor. It could be a call for the Lord in the form of a request to serve on a call committee. It could be a council member asking you about serving on church council. It could be a visit from the pastor saying, I'm going to be out on January 21st and need somebody to preach. And for some, it could be a call from the Lord as they come to the realization that the ministry is the right career path for them. And of course, there is the ultimate call from the Lord, the one that I hope every one of us one day hears when it is our time, the call to come home. My call to you today, be ready. Amen. We will now sing our hymn of the day, You Have Come Down to the Lakeshore, hymn number 784.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able, as we have our creed and confession. In Christ you have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation.
We believe in him, and our heart with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Build yourselves up on your most holy faith.
Pray in the Holy Spirit.
Keep yourselves in the love of God.
Look forward to the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ.
If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation.
And everything old has passed away. Behold, everything has become new.
God has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Therefore, let us be reconciled to God and to one another. Gracious God, have mercy upon us. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. Uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Almighty and merciful God grant us pardon, forgiveness, and remission of all our sins. Amen. Sisters and brothers, rejoice. Mend your ways. Encourage one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share our peace today. Now receive our offerings, and we will sing our offering hymn, Let Us Talents and Tongues Employ, hymn 754.
Thank you.
Please rise for our prayers. We'll start with the offertory prayer. Let us pray. Merciful God, in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you embrace our lives with your great love for humanity. With joy and gladness, we ask that these gifts may be for many a sign of love, and that we may continue to share your divine life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we celebrate Christ embodied in human form, we pray for God's blessing on the church, the world, and all of creation. God, our rock and deliverance, do not let your church be shaken. We trust you never abandon your promises to the most vulnerable among us. Give your church wisdom and empathy in its varied ministries. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, our hope and refuge, you placed the fish in the sea. Guide our care of oceans and all creatures that live in them. Hold us accountable for actions that endanger water sources and the people who depend on them. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, who proclaims judgment and offers mercy, be a model to the leaders of our nation and the world. As they lead, may they follow in your way of justice and truth. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, who cares for the suffering, care for survivors of assault and sexual abuse, and sustain all who minister to them. Keep safe any who live under threat of violence, those living in poverty, and any among us who are ill or in pain. Especially this day, Lord, we pray for Ryan, Roger, Linda, and Cheryl, for Amy, Janice, Faye, Darla, Wanda, Karen, Alan, Gary, and Dean, for Sharon, Clayton, Helen, Lorelei, Judy, and Rory, for Barbara, and for Ricky, Misty, Marcy, Brianna, Algernon, Sue, and Alicia. God of grace, receive our prayer. God of resurrection and new life, as the first disciple shared the good news, empower us and this faith community to be open to your call. When we are uncertain of your call, assure us. When we have strayed from your ways, redirect us. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, who holds the saints against your tender bosom, we trust you welcome them into your care. Comfort those who grieve, even as we place our hope in your salvation. And especially this day, we pray for the family and friends of Donna Harnick Frank. God of grace, receive our prayer. Knowing the Holy Spirit intercedes for us, we offer these prayers and the silent prayers of our hearts in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Announcements for this week. The newsletter deadline is tomorrow. Pastor Chuck and Pastor Stephanie will be back. They'll be back on the 23rd. And in the meantime, if you have need of pastoral care, please contact Betty at the church office. On Wednesday, there's Bible study at English starting at 9 a.m. Their Bible study at Country View at 1 and confirmation at English at 2:40. There's men's Bible study at English on Thursday morning at 7 a.m. And then on Sunday, English and Our Saviors have early worship, and St. Olaf and Trinity have late worship. And following worship next week will be our annual meeting here at St. Olaf. The annual reports for 2023 are done, and there's a box of them back there. So if you didn't grab a copy on your way in and you want to peruse and study in preparation for next week, feel free to grab one on your way out. Are there any other announcements at this time? If not, then we will proceed to our blessing. May the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ fill you with every spiritual blessing. Amen. May the God of faithfulness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Jesus Christ. Amen. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now we will sing together our closing hymn, We Are Marching in the Light, hymn 650. Peace, serve the Lord.
We will. Thanks.